Okay, I think I'm gonna start. First thing I'm just gonna do is apologize for my voice. I'm sort of losing my voice at the moment, so if I become really croaky or just pass out, just carry on. Okay, so the subject of my talk is Glitter and Doom, production's role when making new things. So making new things, it's a great thing. And I sometimes imagine that being a producer is something like being the ringmaster of a glittery circus. And every day the magic can happen and glitter can rain from the skies, but then equally bad things can happen and everyone can feel like they have just seen someone get eaten by the lion. Sometimes you need to fail spectacularly before going on to making something great. And for me, it's the glitter and doom of the process that makes everything so magical. So my core skill is production. I'm now the studio director at Media Molecule, and I was sort of strong-armed into doing this talk at the advisory board meeting last year, and I've been trying to think for ages about what to talk about. It's kind of difficult to find an angle with production because a lot of my approach is instinctual, and it's a big part of my personality. And I don't think that anyone should actually come and replicate any of my processes because our setup is unique and it's imperfect. But I hope to offer some ideas and insights that are going to help you or resonate with you in some way. So anyway, I started by thinking about producers, and these are all producers. They're actually all film and music producers. And I sort of started with looking for a quote. So this one, a producer is a vehicle to get the artist's creativity on the table in a way that is accessible to an audience. And this really chimed with me because it perfectly describes the role of a producer. And yet the quote is from Keith Olsen, and who is a music producer, so it's describing the relationship between a band and a record producer. Obviously, all forms of entertainment, be it film, television, radio, theater, or games, have producers. But this is what they share in common with each other. Clearly, there are a lot of different tasks in the area between the idea and the audience. And so the roles are different within each area. But essentially, we're here to collaborate with the team and ship that thing and get it out to an audience regardless of the industry. People within games, we chase the perfect process all the time. And games development, for me, by its very nature, the process won't actually ever probably settle down, or it certainly won't for a while. And there are some aspects that we should repeat and we should spend time resolving. But especially when you're making new things, you need to be able to be experimental. And when you're also dealing with new hardware platforms or technology, things can get really interesting. So we've got to allow for the fact that it won't always be a smooth ride. And making great stuff with an imperfect process is better than making terrible or mediocre things with a really great process. So to bring it back to the quote, rather than worrying all the time about a process when you're making something new, you need to sort of focus as a producer how you're actually going to help your team get that artist creativity onto the table and then out to an audience. And thinking about my job in this way, I realize that we kind of have like a poor language of how we talk about games production. So I'm going to be drawing parallels between like mainly music and making games as a way to sort of describe myself. Okay, this next one is another one that really chimed with me. So you put the cake dish over the bat phone and protects you from the outside world and helps you actualize the sounds that are in your head. It's another band producer quote. So brand new ideas are really fragile, and it's our job to protect these ideas. And I've always believed massively in shelter and protect, but I actually really like the visual of this one a lot more, so I'll probably say this from now on. So it's protecting the idea and the team and the studio from the outside world. This quote represents how I like to think about my job a lot. It isn't referencing the kind of nightmare scenario where a music producer has been hired by the record label to impose a sound on the band against their will. Clearly, the quote is referencing the kind of producer who wants to help an artist or a band nurture their concept and bring it to fruition, where there is mutual respect for each other and they have the backing and the blessing of their record label. And taking this to heart, sort of remember these guys and how obnoxiously brilliant they were when they were first on the scene. The Beastie Boys, just, I mean, I don't know who was listening to them right back then, but they were just so obnoxiously awful, but they were brilliant. They weren't calmed down, they weren't silenced, they weren't told to behave, and their record producers pushed them to be themselves and make them what they wanted to be, and I think it worked out okay. And when we talk about producers, it's me making a spreadsheet, being a producer, there's often this desire to sort of pigeonhole which type you are. Are you like development manager, are you a creative producer, are you a producer? And effectively, people always want to split us between, do you care about time or do you care about the product? And there's this real tension between creativity and delivery. And so if you work somewhere where there is that split, it can be really difficult to figure out where you sit or where your allegiances lie. And I am, like, I can only really describe myself as a producer. I'm a games producer, and I have a wide and varied set of skills that enable me to be able to think about what we make as a product, and I can schedule, and I can think about people. And it's a skilled job, not one just for people who aren't artists or audio or designers. And it can be a dumping ground for people who are passionate about games but don't actually have one of the other skills and oftentimes don't actually have production skills either. And I think probably that's the role of production differs so much everywhere because the industry has grown so quickly that from the bedroom garage games to then making games with big teams and millions of multi-millions of budget, it grew really fast. And so the role of producer came into existence before anyone had any time to work out what it was, and so we're still sort of figuring all that out. And so as production, we do have a duty to continue to evolve and iterate the role so that it works in the best way for our teams. So I'm kind of assuming that a lot of the room are producers, and a question that I'd sort of focusing on us for a moment, I'd sort of ask you why and how you got into it. And for me, it sort of started when I was a really young girl. I've just always been really bossy, and I've always had a pretty clear idea of what I want out of the world. But it really started for me when I was sort of between 14 and 17, and I was really into music, and I was pretty sure that it was music or film that I'd get into. And I was really passionate about the Sydney music scene, and I made a fanzine, and I hung out with people that did that, and I worked in a record store and after doing work experience there, and I was really driven about this. I was going to gigs and hanging around and all of that. And sort of at a time when I was sort of starting to kind of get into that more and think about putting on gigs and making records with friends, I then got into making short films and disappeared into that world. But it's been when looking back now that I see how important this period was for me. And I was so inspired by the music that I was into, and the punk and indie scene of the 80s and 90s had this real sense of everybody just wanting to get on with stuff and just do things and not be waiting for anything, and it was intoxicating. And it's funny for me to even think that it was a form of rebellion when it's helped me so much in my life. So I declined moving on to film school, and I got a job within the web world because people there were really inspiring, and they had a desire to sort of pioneer how people were using web technology whilst also creating beautiful things. And these influences of my youth preoccupied me recently when I was in a store watching people choose games. And it was a really diverse group of people, and watching them made me ruminate on taste. Right there in front of me, people were developing their taste, and they could have been picking up the item that may have some really big impact on them. It could be the one that helps them play with their siblings in a new way, or help them with communication, or be the one where they build their first bit of content for a game and realize that they're a powerful creative being. And I remember these feelings when I was a teenager and coming across things that had impact. And I remember coming across Riot Girl fanzine and music movement, and their take on modern feminism was my take. It had impact because they weren't bullshitting, and they were so passionate about what they actually believed. And that work had impact, and it inspired me. And all of my major influences are things that have personality and impact. I have a drive to work with people who have personality, uniqueness, and a take, and I'm afraid to put it together. Then I hope that in doing that, we might make something special together, and I want to help them manifest that because that's what I'm good at, and then we can all see it and experience it together, and maybe it may inspire somebody. And these are the things that drive me as a producer and make me want to continue being one. So when I was around eight, when I finally got to England, I got a great job at a Criterion, and it was really... I did sort of got into games in a roundabout way, but the love affair sort of started at that same time when I realized that the people in games are actually amazing. I was really lucky to find the right team, and if you're in your early career, it's really important to find a great studio and someone that you can learn from. And I had a great mentor in Fiona Sperry, and the way that she taught me, the way that I worked with her, has sort of informs how I work now. making Burnout year upon year taught us the craft of making games. I spent the best part of my 20s sort of hunched over a desk playing games and assigning bugs and writing lots of post-it notes. So I definitely know how to make a game. And there came a point where in my career I could be, things could become more personal. And I didn't drive while I made Burnout. I didn't have a car, so it was a bit hard to understand it all the time. I wanted to sort of play around with the skills that I'd learned at Criterion. So Christmas sort of 2005 at my house, this is the invitation I found this morning, Alex and Mark sort of told me about the plans that they had, and the rest was history. So I started the Molecule in 2006, and since the start we've had this mission at Media Molecule to make innovative games within the genre we call creative gaming. And I'm a believer in that we should make things that touch people. And Media Molecule is, the mission is really personal to us because it's a mission that's filled with people who are makers. And it didn't come from a focus test or even figuring this out up front. There are individual and personal stories that are background to building these projects. Little Big Planet's game making genesis goes back to our creative director, Mark Healy's Commodore 64 days as a child. His bedroom hobby has led to him having a 20-year-plus successful career within games. And from him, the idea of making a creative tool that could give people this experience was something that was really personal to him, and he was really passionate about it, and he was unwavering in his conviction that people would actually be there. And that's sort of why we... Oh, no, hang on. Yes, so many people's creativity has been sort of fed by things like that within the Molecule, Tony Hart or Lego. And so their personal mission has been to share the joy they got out of these things as young people and inspire other young people. And so that's sort of why we all make things, isn't it? It's a way of us expressing something. And as makers, we've all been inspired and we seek out inspiration, which then helps us actually make more. And this is a great cycle that we're sort of continuing. So we make sort of special stuff when it comes from a personal place. And creating from this place may not dictate how successful it is, but it will certainly mean that you have a strong chance of creating something that is unique and has impact. So to arrive at these transcendental places as a team, which is obviously the Holy Grail, what you need is to gather this group of people together who are going to jam and collaborate really well, and who are going to get off on each other's ideas and who will be inspired by each other to be better. It's immensely important that there is a crossover of taste and interest and skill and respect. When we hire people, part of the interview is sort of this fitting in bit. And what that really means is there enough of a taste crossover? And do we have the same view of what's good and how will they behave when the crap hits the fan? Because everybody says that hiring great people is their goal. And we all say that with probably the best intentions at heart, but then companies bloat or the wrong people are hired and are never fired. And the curse of the 7 out of 10 person is a problem industry-wide and not crap enough to fire and not good enough to elevate things. The primary role as a producer within this process is to hold people accountable to hiring the right people. And another way of saying it is to sort of help people stay focused on what they need and to not fall prey to false economies or desperation. Desperation can set in, but anyone who's ever had to manage out anybody who's really great, a really great person, but just not the right fit or just not up to scratch should be nodding their heads. If we're to make these things with personality, and personality is core to making new stuff, then people are really core to that. And to truly create something personal means that people are giving something of themselves. And I'll never forget an artist telling me their dilemma of creating something bad meant the beginning of the end, and creating something amazing was just the last amazing thing they would do. It really broke my heart. And even though it's a commercial enterprise, we're having to iterate and we're having to change things all the time. Our creative people do pay us whole tax. We need to be aware of that. And being aware of this tax that they pay to contribute their ideas and ultimately finish a project is important for all of us. You've been hired partly, hopefully, because of your people skills and your ability to draw things out of people. So your ability to create and sustain good chemistry with people is paramount, and your ability to be sensitive to what people have to give to birth ideas is also crucial. When we make new things as a producer, we need to marry together the skills we have with the fact that we're sort of trying to help this group of people. We're collaborating together, and that can create the perfect partnership of creation and delivery. It's definitely a push and pull relationship. And I've been thinking about trying to find a way of talking about the sort of being creative without toe-stepping. And so I'm going to sort of talk a bit about music producers again. And there are many kinds of band and producer relationships, but in this scenario where they've chosen to work with each other, and have some kind of mutual respect for each other's ability, they may have some of the same challenges that we do. They're working with a highly creative group of people who have a flavor and a strong view of what they want to make, and their job is to help that group navigate towards what the group want to make. And I'm sure that the ones that I respect a lot anyway are judged on whether or not the record was successful, and not just commercially and critically, but most importantly by the band. And that's how I want to be judged also. I want to be judged on the end result and how much it matches up to what the team wanted and how I help them actually navigate towards that experience and how much they want to go through it again with me. And that role does require creativity. It requires you to know what good is and where the quality bar is set and to have an opinion of your own. And otherwise, you're just not going to stand any chance of helping the team be able to reach it. You're often going to be the person who needs to give the team the reality checks on where they are versus where they want to be. And so you need to know when it's not there yet and have thoughts and suggestions on how to help facilitate them getting back there. I don't have the solutions, but I do help pull the team towards a higher quality product by helping them get back on the path or know when they're off it. And I really want what we create to be better than what they were ever expecting. So one of the most crucial relationships on the team is the creative leads and the main producer, and it's imperative that I know what their people are aiming for, and so I can help figure out what help. I have to figure out what they need from me. So criterion, when I was working for Alex Ward and Fiona Sperry, my job was to sort of track delivery, but a large part of what I did was sort of cheerlead the team, and over time it was to work with Alex to get what he was thinking out to the team in a way that would be useful. So shipping a game annually meant that there was always a pressing issue of time was always a pressing issue. And so getting everything done on time and ready for our kind of annual alpha panic was something that I sort of dealt with. Making sequels with the arms race of a racing genre is tough. And so as a producer on such things, you're sort of trying to keep the team laser focused on being a cut above and knowing what all the other games are doing and knowing how to like be different from all of those. And I felt responsible, like probably more than necessary, to the team sort of achieving 10 out of 10. And so that, and the process was so grueling that it just wouldn't have made it worth it otherwise. When I joined Media Molecule, this is us back in 2006, looking all young and photoshopped. My role in the early days of sort of LBP was to provide some structure initially to how things work. So add in milestones, manage the Sony relationship, and ensure that all the bits hung together. The biggest differences between there and Criterion were the fact that there were four directors, four creative directors. Mark was creative director, wasn't really cut and dry. All four contribute massively to the creative direction of the project. But the guys had so many ideas and were so desperate to ship that we had a really great crossover. I brought my console experience and sort of tried to get us to look at things as a whole project. And so, you know, make sure we had like sort of reviewing and iterating and all that kind of thing. And they sort of really taught me looseness, and I sort of somehow sort of taught them sort of how to come together. But my role at Media Molecule has evolved to the beat of the studio, where we've been through sort of lots of phases. Being a new startup and launching a service and not really having a clue, to being a service support through having sort of DLC community and sort of struggling through that again. And doing a sequel where we actually sort of started to know what we were doing a little bit more. And then we thought, what the hell, let's ditch that and do two new IPs. So the last 7 years have been filled with lots of change, and we sort of moved from one team to many teams operating service, back to one, back to service. And I feel more than ever my role is to get the creativity onto the table and out to the audience. But there's just a lot more logistics these days. And in the Molecule tradition, the two new IPs we're doing are based on the personalities and personal stories from within the studio. At the moment, my world is very much to do with this young man, Rex Crowell. And one of the big reasons to move to two projects was that we wanted Rex to have a project to lead creatively. He'd have thought that he'd wanted to explore a world that actually leaked into a real world and a real world that leaked into back into it. And anyone who knows Rex knows that he is fabulously talented and wonderful, and I love him dearly. Then we're only partway through Tear Away, so it's sort of not time to talk about all of the gory details, but I think that a couple of things have been reinforced to me about making new stuff that's probably useful. I'm just going to quickly show like a trailer for some people who may not have seen what we're doing there. Oh, I have to press the button.
Oh, I remember this place from when I first arrived. I wandered alone but somehow survived. The trees were so tall, reaching up to the sky, that I couldn't believe my eyes. Boys, I couldn't believe my eyes. Well, support I found from its noise and its stench. To the tavern I did go for my thirst to be quenched. An old docker, he warned me of a terrible sight. Oh, he couldn't believe his eyes. Boys, he couldn't believe his eyes. Big and scary, they're not hairy, they are scaly claws and even fabric. Run away, they're after you.
Of a journey. A long while earlier, the game looked a little bit like that. And the finger looked a little bit like this. Because we were a little bit distracted by this. And we were a little bit distracted by this video that's not just the loading screen, we were a bit distracted by a video that's not playing. We'll just move on. We were a little bit distracted by things. Oh no, now my machine's still working.
It's nearly there.
You're not streaming, man.
Extremely.
I know. Oh, yes, they
have. Okay, we're not going to do that. but then we sort of started to get a little bit back on track, and we sort of started to make something that looked a little bit more like this. I'm not going to stay there. So, what did Rex sort of need from production, sort of to help us sort of guide it from one place to another? Firstly, he needed for us as for me as a producer to sort of understand that there was sort of prototypes that were important stepping stones along the way, and all of these are sort of interesting to have had some sort of impact on where we are now. I often think of sort of development as a spiral, and you start on the outer ring. With the broad concepts, and it becomes more honed as time goes by until you've reached the middle and have arrived at the purest version. As you make something new, you all learn what's important and you focus on that, and all of these prototypes will really help with that. Throughout development, we had sort of advanced on several fronts, but unfortunately the things that were most important to Rex still hadn't been proven, and we've become sidetracked and focusing on sort of huge ambitious features like a procedural world. Procedural world generation, which was needed to support a kind of location-based GPS gameplay that we were looking at. But we sort of lost focus on other features, such as the rear touch finger, which were the sort of part of the original core idea for the game, and they were sort of been denied the love and that they needed as a result. And so this lack of love and attention meant that sort of a lot of that gameplay was in an unfinished state. Excuse me, and it made it difficult for the team to sort of get behind it, which would then result in them not making use of it when they were sort of designing gameplay. So the team needed to be excited by the feature for them to want to use it. And I think we as games makers every now and then can fall into the trap of thinking that we don't need to finish something in order to prove it to ourselves, to want to engage with it, and that we can fill in the blanks using our imaginations. But if you're making something new, then you really need to make sure that you focus on implementing the core aspects really, really well, and the things that are actually going to stand out and be fun, as it's these unique and special things in your game that need to be implemented and iterated until proven or cut, as it's these that are going to be the make and break. And bad implementations can make a really good idea look bad, and good implementations can actually mask weak ideas. So the crucial thing for production at a stage like this is to know where the creative director's head's at, and the rear touch finger was the gateway to the godly powers, and the fact that we hadn't pushed through and implemented this properly meant that we weren't getting there and that we were straying away from the purity of the idea. So our role within production is to guide bit back to the, where the creative leads want it to be, and we have to be their guardian. It's totally natural on the outer side of the spiral to have more than you need, and that can feel really overwhelming to some people, but it really can't to you as a producer. You sort of have to be the person that can help guide it back. But to move from this outer ring down to the next level of focus, what Rex needed from me was just support, and I needed to put that cake dish over the bat phone. As we started to get sort of feedback from every which way, and our green light was coming up, and people on the team felt that there was pressure to keep sort of certain concepts, sort of like GPS. And I needed to ensure that Rex and Dave from work had the chance to review everything and figure out the priorities and the core of the game. So we'd realized some things were going to be really hard to pull off, such as the creating a whole world procedurally. And so it meant that we were going to have to let some people down as they were really into the things that they'd pursued. So the way that we dealt with this was I just sent Rex and Dave into a room to review the various ideas. And we agreed that they needed to come out with a revised cut of the concept, and they didn't need to include any of the ideas that they didn't like or agree with, and no matter how prominent and no matter how much pressure on us there was to keep them. Because we're going to be the ones that are going to be there at 3 a.m. in the morning solving all of the millions of problems. And greenlighting something you don't want to make has got to be worse than greenlighting something that, did I say that with the right one? Yeah, greenlighting something you don't want to make is worse than not being greenlit, I think. I mean, it would be for me. I don't think you're going to have the passion or the energy to be able to actually see it through to being a high-quality finished product if you don't actually have the desire to make it in the first place. And so they sort of came out with a very clear view of what we wanted to do, the IOTA delivery message, fantasy, sort of continuing the building, the fantasy in a papercraft world, and the world being a world that you hold in your sort of godlike hands. We lost the GPS, we lost the real world, we lost the Paper Zelda comparisons, everyone could understand it, we were all really happy with what we had dropped, and we'd had just got a brilliant new graphics programmer, so the paperiness of the world was sort of starting to feel so much better anyway. So it was sort of really good. And teams like nothing more than clear creative direction, and so with everybody really buzzing, we decided to sort of stop everything for a while and focus on the area that needed immediate improving, and that was the godlike powers. So we had the whole team focus on that for a week, and then that sort of turned into 4 in a kind of game jammy sort of way. We meant they could rapidly prototype some things. And I'm just going to show you just one of the videos from that. We do a thing where we record
visual or sound all of our
Pentab audio.
Yeah. Basically, this is a megaphone. You can run around and yell.
Ah!
Ah! And this is like the beginning of the drum. And these were after a couple of days of just implementing stuff and just trying out and giving everybody the free rein to just use all of the Vita inputs they could to just sort of have a laugh with. And they've all kind of ended up being things that we've used. And that's what ended up with us with this one. That process we ended with. Is this playing?
Oh,
most of those things did come out of the game jam. So I am a big fan of Alice in Wonderland, and I really like the metaphor of falling down rabbit holes, mainly because I don't think that this is actually a really negative thing or really avoidable when you're making new things. And it can actually lead to some good adventures and also can lead to some dead ends, but it's almost, you almost always have to end up going through this. So the beginning is when you have the time to be able to truly play around, and so you can't panic when things don't work out. The more rapid and cheaply you do it, obviously, the better. But sometimes it really is the grand failure that leads to something magnificent. You have to sort of look for those opportunities. And if you really do not end up knowing what to do, you need to sort of course correct. And I sort of suggest course correcting to the wild side. You need to be rock and roll, and you need to be courageous. Your team's wildest ideas might just be their best. And it's at moments like this where the team will need your courage as a producer, and they will need their courage. The same rock and roll attitude that causes a band to get up on stage and confidently present themselves and their message to the world. Production's role at this stage is to facilitate this sort of course correction. When a project is lost, your creative directors are the bright shining lights, your first port of call. And when they are lost, you just need to really help them trace back to the beginning. Why have they made this project in the first place, and help them build it back up from there? People will rely on you to find ways to start conversations and to talk actually about what's happening and what people think needs to happen to improve the situation. You need to help people be able to zoom out and look at the big picture of things. A truly great producer can draw a team together when they need to and leaves them to it when they need to. They can raise it sort of to DEFCON level, all out nuclear panic, 3 weeks before anyone has noticed, including the publisher. My sort of point there is that a great producer takes the team to levels it could never have reached otherwise and isn't afraid to make the hard decisions. It's an immensely creative and instinctive process, as well as being very hard work. So you need to sort of ask yourselves of your team, do they sort of trust you to know exactly what risks to take and which ones to leave on the table, or vice versa? And do they sort of trust you to be able to see the big picture when they can't? So what was really needed to sort of turn Tearaway into a project firing on all cylinders was getting the team to work really well together, and then to sort of continue moving on with momentum. And so there was this moment many years ago when I was working on Burnout Revenge, which was sort of a particularly grueling project, where I stood on a table at our local pub and I mapped out our path to finaling using Lord of the Rings and Sauron and our quest to get to Mount Doom as my metaphor. It was very memorable because I was very passionate, and we were very bonded in our challenge. And I'm reminded by it by one of my workmates all the time. And it makes me smile because I really recall the emotion that I felt about getting to the end. And as a producer, you sort of have to be that sort of crazy one who's ready to, who's sort of leading the charge to the end with such vigor that you're unstoppable. And if you don't set that beat, then somebody else might, but chances are they won't, because they've probably got a whole lot of other things on their mind and it's your job. We know that we all sort of know that moment of reaching the end and where you've actually created the amazing thing that you're proud of and has the personality that you've really worked hard for and is ready to be shared with the world. And it's an incredible feeling, and the team really rely on us being the ones to help them get there. So at the start, my focus is very much sort of trying to figure out what's going on in our creative leads' heads and sort of help the sort of fragile thoughts knit together into something more. And then there's this moment which I've kind of labeled as the eclipse, which is basically the moment where the sort of idea is no longer fragile and it's known enough by the team for it to sort of lead the team. And then once that sort of moment has happened, I sort of turn a bit more into a fan and sort of reviewing it as a finished thing and making sure we always have something amazing, the equivalent of sort of redoing every sort of take. And anyone who's been through filing with me we'll know that we spend a lot of time sort of reviewing and perfecting and challenging ourselves to make sure that we're finishing. So some of the most important work I do day to day is a simple act of just making sure that things happen. When I know that areas aren't consistent or up to scratch, I just organize reviews, or I make people speak together when I know that they need to. I hold people accountable and I have really high expectations, and people know that. I don't really care about being bad cop, because my focus is to make sure that all of that soul tax that people are paying and this initial pain that we've gone through actually manifests into something that we're proud of. And we as producers, we really fail if the game doesn't live up to that potential. And no amount of postmortems or even sort of fairly okay scores will change that, because once it's done, it's done. My slide seems to have stopped moving. So, five rules to make it happen. You've got to know the vision and know what the big picture is and sort of understand not just like what it is in writing, but actually why they want to make it in the first place. It's always really important to sort of have some idea of personally why it's important to them. And it sort of can't be your big picture or your vision. It has to be your creative leads. You need to know what is happening, and that means you need to sort of speak to people honestly and be speaking to them all the time on the team and kind of really having a gauge of what's going on. A simple exercise for you to do if you need one is, and I'm sure everyone already does this, but just it's something that I find really useful and do all the time, is just write down everybody's names and then just ponder on them and think about them, what they're doing, what they need, what I feel like I need to communicate to them, what I think they need to communicate to me. And then workflow is obviously really important. It's kind of the unglamorous thing, but basically, do you actually know how hard it is to commit something into the game? Is it really difficult? Like, how much faff is there in between having a thought and actually it appearing on screen? It's really important that we put effort into making that good. Play the game. You need to be playing the game like an editor would read a book draft, or a music producer would listen to a song, or a film crew would watch rushes. And it's the only way to actually know if things are coming together, and particularly when we're making something new, because it's forming right in front of you. And sometimes things that you think are important aren't things that sort of you felt would stand out. And it's the only way for you to be able to really tell how important it is to organize a review to get something signed off. And if we can't get it to feel good now, then I ask you to sort of think about what you're imagining is actually going to be done in the filing phase to make it good, and just get that done now instead. It's your job to sort of make that happen, and people rely on that to happen. Otherwise, you sort of can end up with that soup. And make sure your team play it too. That's the other obviously really important thing, and make sure people are thinking about what the end product needs to be. Because when you're finaling, you won't suddenly be able to rewrite lots of things. And once the game is shipped, you can't really change things. So this means everything that you do every day has got to be working towards that goal. And the only way to judge it is by playing the game. Yes, so don't wait. Oh, no, this picture's gone. There was a picture there, but it's gone. Doesn't matter. So find a way to plan that works for your team. And for us, we sort of have a mentality of jamming. And I don't mean like game jams. I just mean a way of collaboration and working together. It's more like the idea of a band riffing together than just focused game jams. And this sort of makes me think about the Rolling Stones, and they formed in 1962. And whilst most of the band has changed, and their producers certainly have, despite some gaps, they've stuck together. And sort of 50 years later, this group sort of is bound together by music, and they've survived very large amounts of dysfunction. And I suspect that that's due to a large amount of respect for each other and knowing that they're better off together and than apart, and also the commercial success that they've experienced, obviously. The early chemistry was there between them very early on, and enough to get them together in the first place. But it did take sort of mammoth amounts of practicing and being thrown together to get this bond. So unlike many forms of entertainment, games teams do, largely we do stay together for a long time. And at MM Media Molecule, we don't gather a team together per project and then disperse at the end. We sort of stay together. And 7 years in, the more we know each other, the more interesting it is to work with each other. So this analogy of jamming as our production methodology is something that I actually have this post-it note stuck to my monitor, and I look at it kind of every day to sort of remind me, when I look around the studio and I see that everybody is collaborating and jamming and the games are evidently progressing, then I'm happy. And sometimes you can just sort of feel that it's sort of broken down and the games aren't moving on, and that makes me unhappy. And I kind of want to figure out how to fix it. And so as soon as kind of everybody is jamming again and sort of collaborating again and sort of moving towards that goal again, they can get to that special creative place with each other and build respect for each other and become a close-knit team. But I often sort of witness people getting sort of worried or worrying unnecessarily also about tensions. This is Mark and Kareem, if anyone doesn't recognize them. And so, as producers, our nurturing side can often mean that we want to be able to protect people from experiencing creative pain. But sometimes it is kind of inevitable. And we need to make sure that there isn't a personal attack between people and that people are supported. But the flip side of chemistry can be to have a certain amount of tension. So every day isn't going to be bliss or harmonious working, but the key is obviously to make sure that your team are respectful and people need to acknowledge if things go over the mark. But some of the world's most incredible partnerships have been fed by healthy doses of creative tension, and so it's important we don't just sort of always try to put out those fires and try and make everything okay all the time, because sometimes you just need to have a bit of that. So 25 sort of left-right brain people getting together to experiment and arrive at a commercial product that they're all proud of and have come up from scratch. It's like, what could go wrong? So I like to embrace the chaos that that inevitably creates, and it's a big contributor to the feelings of glitter and doom that I sort of like. So communication is just as important externally as it is internally. I'm making Little Big Planet now and Tearaway, both of our role is to continuously educate people on what we're doing, and so they have the best information. Like when you're making a new project, like you're moving at such a rate of knots that it's very difficult for people external to sort of keep up with you and to kind of then stay with you when you're talking about marketing plans and PR plans. And it's sort of important. And so we've sort of started, we do sort of all these fairly lo-fi things. This one has got kind of weird sound, but we've sort of started making these sort of very lo-fi videos where we just talk through our milestones and sort of send them over. And that we're sort of finding that works really well for us. So the other, but a big part of that is to making sure that you sort of protect your team from having to worry about things that they don't need to worry about. And sometimes there are people who are kind of wanting, you know, you have conversations which might sort of force people into thinking that we need to pander to an audience. And if you're like us, sort of, you know, with a lot of the team, you don't want to, there's parts of the business that they need to be exposed to and parts that they don't. And so, you know, sometimes people make us a bit afraid of our audiences, but I don't really think that we should be. And when you're making something new, you sort of just have to focus on on sort of being able to kind of get that thing out. And it can be tempting at the last moments of a project to want to finish it so much that you lose your mouse. Sorry. It can be tempting at the last moments of a project to want to finish so much that you can renege on really important things or get scared of how far you're taking it, and to think perhaps that you've all gone mad. But it's in these cases that you sort of maybe just have a few trusted sources that can play the game for you. But there are always going to be people not taking risks, and there are always going to be people thinking about specific audiences. But it's those that do take risks, I think, are the projects that make an impression. And so to keep sort of the whole circle of creative life going, we all have to do that. And so as a production, we have to be the guardian of this battle, sort of to keep the faith. And we always have to back talented people, and we have to let their personalities shine through in their work. And we should back them when they need our support, and then we need to make sure that the team collaborates. And at any time people lose faith, we need to cheerlead them and avoid the compromises in the last minute. We sort of just need to make great stuff, and then the rest will follow. So some of you in the room probably won't be working for publishers anymore, and some of you will. And the way that I've always worked with publishers is a fair amount of transparency, and there's never been a point in pretending that you're somewhere that you're not, as they can largely see through that anyway. The thing that they're most interested in always is sort of what your plan is. And if you're in a crisis, it's always sort of good to be honest, as long, you know, they will have seen that before. The thing that they're just going to be wanting to know is that you know what you're actually doing about it and how you're sort of going to get back on course. We've been incredibly lucky working with Sony. We were small and they've sort of never really interfered with what we do creatively. And thankfully for us, that sort of set a precedent for how we've worked with them the whole way along. We have a really strong relationship with all of the producers that we work there, and there's a mutual respect, just even if we don't agree all the time. And as a producer, it may be your role to sustain these relationships, and you need to know when you need to use the cake dish and put it over the phone, and you need to know when you have to open the doors and let people in to see what's actually going on. Someone had said to me a little while ago that I have a reputation for giving a good no, and I'm not really sure what that means other than I behave as bouncer for Media Molecule, much as an annoyance to people who want things from us, and sometimes that cake dish comes in very handy for me. The most important thing with making new things is that it's very challenging, but it's a lot of fun. If you have the team and you believe in their vision and you can actually do your job, then you should be on course to be able to do something. So you just need to not be afraid. When we were making Little Big Planet, we really had no idea what we were doing, and with regard to the logistics of a UGC service, we all learned that the hard way, and we didn't really know if anyone would create anything until the beta trials, which were a beta, which was probably too late to figure that out anyway. But when we started to see those level numbers drop up, we were just so happy. We had sort of this belief, though, and a united desire to sort of jump into the unknown and give it a go and to figure it out as we went. And we lived in this world for 6 years and then decided that it was time to jump into another unknown with two new peers, and it's been so hard. And the last years have seen us, many of us really overstretched and things taking longer than they should, and many of our internal processes broken down. And it's been really hard, and we've got so much wrong, but I feel like within production we've sort of been steering these sort of icebergs. But sort of despite the mistakes that we've made, we've all learned lessons about the games we're making and the people that we are, and I think we're sort of making games that only we would make, and there's something special about that. I've had so many joyous moments, and I'm so happy to see the world of Tearaway come to life and the team overcome the challenges that they've had. And it's exciting to see everyone knuckle down for the final stretch. LBP and now Tearaway, our other project, will stretch us, and the other one we announced, well, we sort of showed some stuff of. They will stretch us, but that's because we're sort of reaching for something. And we're taking creative risks, and we're taking studio risks, and we're generally not staying still. But that does mean we can get to somewhere special, and we're going to be telling a personal story. And making something close to us means that we can sort of deliver experiences that are really unique for our audiences. So just sort of coming back to these, I think these are, I'll probably write these on post-it notes, put them on my desk as well. These are two things to remember. Glitter and doom. Making new things means that you have to be a good producer, probably a really good producer. And we all sort of struggle with that. I'm having to learn like every day and have days where I feel like I'm good and days where I feel like I'm really crap. But you just need to work hard and you actually need to just love the glitter and doom of development. And so my sort of call to action with any producers is that you will have joined the industry for a reason and you've probably got a whole bank load of interests and passions and things that you're into. And you probably may have been knocked back at some points and told that production is not important or you're not part of the team or you're not creative or you don't matter or number crunches and all that stuff. But I just don't think we should work with people like that. I know that I can add to things and I'm really confident about that. And you need to sort of, I think the way that we need to think about it is that we can be critical to making a game successful and we can be critical to helping teams birth new ideas and sort of be a part of that process, and you really can pull your team towards that. So even when you're just tracking something, you need to be focused on the project being the best that it can be. And the industry right now isn't going to keep teams that release average games. But it's also a moment where, you know, we can make things amazing. There are all sorts of games out there now, you know, on all sorts of different platforms. And a lot of the things that we all talk about and get celebrated in, like, the awards ceremony last night are games that have personality. And they're games that sort of celebrate the sort of united creative direction of a studio. And I think that's truly the most rewarding work to do. So we should sort of try to figure out how to help our studios towards that and be a part of that process. So remember those words. Thank you. That's it. Okay.